गुड आफ्टरनून मैम।
वेलकम टू
गुड आफ्टरनून
द
मैम।
यस वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून. इवन दो इन द लिंक दैट वुड बी सेंट फॉर यू ऑल फॉर ऑनलाइन क्लासेस द टाइम शेड्यूल माइट बी मोर बट यूजुअली अकॉर्डिंग टू द टाइम टेबल आई विल बी टेकिंग क्लासेस. सो इट वुड बी वेनसडे 12 to 1, थर्सडेज 10 to 12, एंड फ्राइडे वंस अगेन 12 to 1. एंड इफ एट ऑल आई नीड एनी एक्स्ट्रा क्लासेस आई विल लेट यू ऑल नो. सो आई जस्ट होप वी कैन स्टार्ट टूडेज सेशन. एंड बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन आई वुड ऑल्सो लाइक टू टेल दैट इफ एनी वन हैज़ एनी डाउट रिगार्डिंग द सब्जेक्ट माइट बी अ वेरी स्मॉलर वन और माइट बी बिगर डाउट्स कन्फ्यूजन्स और इफ यू नीड एनी ऑफ द थिंग्स टू बी रिपीटेड प्लीज लेट मी नो. इफ यू आर कम्फर्टेबल इनफ यू कैन ड्रॉप अ मैसेज इन योर क्लास ग्रुप ईदर इन योर व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप और इवन इन योर टेलीग्राम ग्रुप. एंड इफ यू आर नॉट कम्फर्टेबल टू शेयर दैट इंफॉर्मेशन अमोंग योर क्लासमेट्स यू कैन ऑल्सो इवन टेक्स्ट मी पर्सनली ईदर इन व्हाट्सएप और इन द टेलीग्राम ऐप. So please do not take your MBA lightly. Even though it is online classes a bit difficult to listen, please try to concentrate and try to understand the concepts not only for this particular subject but for all the subjects that you have to learn. So I hope we can start today's session. And in our earlier classes, we were discussing regarding MBO. And if I am not wrong, we were discussing regarding the process of MBO. In our today's session, we shall discuss the benefits of MBO. Now that you have understood what is objectives, what is its relevance for an organization, and what is management by objective, to define the benefits of MBO, it should not be a problem for you all. Now speaking about benefits, in the recent years, MBO has resulted in great innovations in business organization. Now those people who are in favor of MBO concept, they usually tell that this particular MBO is the successor to Taylor's mental revolution. Now it is a new way of thinking regarding engaging in and also in collective effort of everybody who is there in the organization. And they also claim that when a particular organization it works on the basis of management by objective, those organization they become performance oriented organization and they tend to grow and also develop and become socially useful in many different ways that is possible. Now it depends upon you how you would like to speak regarding the benefits. You can tell it point wise or you can tell it in brief. But the benefit, when you usually try to explain a concept in point by point, is that the one who is reading or assessing would be able to understand your answer in a better way. Now here are some of the benefits that has been mentioned. So let us try to understand each one of it. Now the first one is clear goals. That is to tell when we adopt MBO in the organization, it usually produces clear and measurable goals for the organization. Now, goals are set in such an atmosphere wherein there shall be participation, mutual trust and confidence among the individuals who are working in the organization. And people tend to discuss especially the superior and subordinates. And usually the latter one will be shooting for right goals. Now usually why MBO becomes successful is that more and more participation of subordinates in the decision making or strategy making, it usually increases commitment from their side, and also it results in making the goals better. Now there has been some of the research that has been done whether to tell whether MBO has actually benefited the organizations or not, and all such research, they indicate that individuals are more likely to be highly committed to the objectives of the organization, especially when they have shared a hand in setting such objectives. Now joint goal setting sessions, usually it increases the team spirit and also communication among the different groups of the organization. Now all this results in making the goals of the organization a way more better, and also it results in cutting off all the confusion that might arise. Now the second one is better planning. Now it is said that MBO, it sharpens the planning process. It does it by specifying goals and procedures of a very analytical thinking or concrete thinking. Now they tend to force specific planning into setting highly specific, challenging yet attainable goals. Now developing action programs which would be connected with time schedules within which it has to be completed, by providing the resources for accomplishing all the goals, and also by discussing and removing any of the problems to performance. And all such activities demand careful advanced planning. Now passivity will always give way to activity. Now the third benefit is that it is said that MBO facilitate controls. Now this shall be done when the goals are being clearly and verifiably set. Now when a goal is clear and verifiable, they provide a guarantee for exercising better control. That is to tell, whenever we find the objective of the organization is being detracted, we would exactly know that we'll have to take measures, and in taking measures definitely there shall be contribution of both the higher level management and also the lower level management. Now the fourth benefit is objective appraisal. Now it is said that MBO provides a basis for analyzing or evaluating the performance of an individual. And because all these goals or objectives, it has been togetherly set by both the superiors and subordinates. Now when the goals are specifically set, MBO, it will allow persons to better control their own performance. Now the individuals, they shall be given the freedom to, you know, monitor their own activities. And whenever the organization is such that it is a very pleasant and stimulating organization, individuals would definitely not be subjected to any kind of domination or any kind of severe control from their boss or from their superiors. And usually they would be trained to be, you know, disciplined and also self-controlled. Now, whenever in an organization, a management is run by self-control, it usually replaces the domination in the management. Now, all such appraisals would be more objective and it would be impartial, as employee performance shall always be measured against some of the variable objectives. There shall be no room for any kind of subjective thinking. Rather, it shall always be a objective based decisions. Now the next one is motivational force. Now, one of the main characteristic of MBO is that both the appraiser and also appraisee, or the superior and the subordinate, both of them shall be committed to the same objective of the organization. And when this is the case, it shall always force the managers to think of the results-oriented planning rather than planning for activities or work. Now it compels forward planning and also living life in an, you know, anticipatory mode rather than responding to the events. Now whenever the roles of every individual shall be clearly mentioned, it should always reduce any kind of anxiety, ambiguity, or in simple to tell, any kind of confusion among the employees. And it also allows the managers increased opportunities, you know, to provide subordinates with a better fix on the job and also clearly tell the path for the personal rewards of their subordinates. The next benefit is better morale. Now concentrate a little bit here. It is morale, not moral. Now morale and morale are two different things. Now, how shall MBO brings morale? Now, it usually encourages commitment rather than compliance. That is to tell, it involves rather than compels people to make. Now, it is at, you know, functional in terms of what top management demands and developmental in terms of people at work. Now the two techniques, that is participative decision making and the two-way communication, it encourages the subordinates to communicate both freely and also honestly. Now when this happens, it usually minimizes misunderstanding about what is that the organization expects from each of the employees or even from the subunits of the organization. Now when there is participation, clarified goals, improved communication, now all together these can be considered as, you know, having a tonic effect or a medicinal effect on the psychology of the subordinates. Now, one of the benefits is that results or result-oriented philosophy. Now, it is a result-oriented philosophy basically because MBO is practical and rational management philosophy. Now, those who want to establish the organization under this, you know, system, they shall always be forced to come up with specific individual and group goals. Now, develop appropriate action plans, or it marshals the resources properly and establishes the control standards that are necessary. Now, these are some of the benefits. Now, I hope whatever we discuss, it helps you in understanding the concept better. That is the first thing. And the second thing that I would like to mention is that there is never a compulsion for you all to write whatever we have discussed. Now, what you want to write, what you have understood, and how you would like to present your answer, it entirely depends upon you. What I would like to suggest is try understand each of the concept and make your own answer. Do not restrict yourself to what has been given. It is always better if you give your ideas, but then you should remember that your idea should be regarding the concept we are speaking. It should not go way beyond what we are trying to tell. Now, there are, no matter how effective MBO can be or how effective any of the element can be, there shall definitely be some of the drawbacks for each of it. Likewise, even management by objectives has its own limitations. Now, MBO is not the cure for all the problems that can be there in the organization. Now, there is, you know, quite often many organizations, you know, they look at MBO as an instant solution to their problems. But they fail to recognize that MBO always demands careful planning and also careful implementation so that it can be successful. Now, even this technique, like all other techniques, can be no better than the people who try to apply it. That is to tell, those who wish to bring in MBO, they should be very well versed regarding what they are doing and how shall be they doing it. Now, the first limitation or drawback is that it is pressure oriented. That is to tell, now MBO as an, you know, practice or as a technique can be altogether by itself self-defeating in the long run, since it shall be connected with the reward-punishment psychology. Now, this reward-punishment psychology is definitely a violation of the integrity of subordinates' personality. Now, there are chances that MBO program sometimes it might discriminate against superior performance. Now, it also tries to indiscriminately force improvement on all employees, and at times many of them may penalize the very people who are most productive in the organization. Now, the second limitation is MBO is time consuming. That is to tell, MBO demands a great deal of time You know, to carefully think and set objectives at each and every level of the organization. Now, initially or in the beginning or the first step is, it has to bring confidence in subordinates in the new system. Now, superiors may have to hold many meetings. Now, the formal periodic progress and final review sessions also consume a lot of time. And the third limitation is, it definitely does increase paperwork. Now, when the organization thinks of, setting MBO in the organization, it usually introduces a very big tidal wave of maybe newsletters, instruction, booklets, training manuals, questionnaires, reports, performance data into the organization. Now, to understand or to be in continuous recognition of what is going on in the organization, the managers, they might force or they might demand regular reports and also data in writing, which might result in grueling exercise in filling out forms. Now, it has created one more paper mill, is what Howell, one of the management thinker, speaks of. And one more limitation is regarding the goal or the goal setting problem. Now, MBO works effectively when the most important measurable objectives have been jointly agreed upon. But then there are chances that it might work less under some of the circumstances. The first one definitely is when the variable goals are difficult to set. And the second one is that goals tend to take, precedence over the people who use it. Now, MBO, it forces on end results, and it may, foster an, or it might bring such a behavior or attitude, wherein which any action is acceptable as long as it helps achieve the organizational goals. Now, that is one of the biggest problem. Now, consequently, if at all the management tend to take a bad decision, they are made that would ultimately harm the organization. And one of the limitation is also that goals shall definitely be inflexible and also rigid. Now, one of the limitations also speaks of that there has been too much importance given or overemphasis on the quantifiable and the measurable results, which can be easily measured instead of important results. Now, many important qualitative goals may be like job satisfaction, employee attitudes, are always lost sight of. And also, MBO is having the limitation of that it overemphasizes the short-term goals, at the expenses of long-term goals. Now, attempts to show results force usually manages to cut down the costs in areas where a long-term perspective would be more fruitful to the organization. Now, the last limitation is regarding the organizational problems. Now, one thing regarding MBO we should remember is that it is not the one final solution or one final cure for all the organization problems. Now, it is not for everybody. Now, there are chances that sometimes MBO can create more problems than it can solve it. Now, the first problem is that the failure to teach this particular philosophy to each and everyone who are participating. Many a times, management by objective is brought into in the organization as a technique with little introduction of it or little explanation and also training of MBA. Now, there might also be chances that because of this technique, there shall be a failure to limit the objective. And when an organization has too many objectives, it shall lead to confusion or to prioritize the objectives and create a sense of fear, confusion or panic among subordinates. Now, it is inconsistent with the management philosophy. Now, under this MBO technique or program, managers are usually forced to take a 180 degree turn from their present way of thinking and acting and adopting a new way of system. Now, instead of planning and deciding things for others, they shall always be advised to invite subordinates and plan for work in an environment of participation, much which is to their dislike. Now, there are also chances that this program might be used as a whip to control the performance of the employees, and it might also lead to a tug of war in which subordinates, they try to set the lowest possible target and superior to fix a highest possible target. Now, there are also chances that the managers, they might turn MBO into a sham and they might start playing games. Or in simple words, they might bring in politics in the organization, which shall definitely prove very much harmful for the organization. Now, even though there are limitations, even though there are a lot of problems, now there has been some of the suggestions that have been given so that there shall be more and more effectiveness of MBO. Now, one of the main reason this particular technique fails in most of the organization is that those who have the authority to recognize the potential characteristics of the MBO and the implementation process, they fail to implement. Now, the fault is not in the technique of MBO, but it is in how it is being used in the organization. Definitely, like any other thing that is being implemented, even there is a right way of doing MBO and a wrong way of doing it. Now, these are some of the steps how it can be made effective. First one is commitment from the side of organization. Now, the most successful MBO should always allow the top level manager to explain, coordinate and also guide the program. Now, without their support and commitment, this particular technique can never be implemented rightly. Now, this also presents a very challenging task for managers. They should always feel that the program is important for the organization and shall definitely bring in results. Now, the shift from planning to accomplishment of specific goals is definitely not an easy task. Now, the joint goal setting, participation, in planning and decision making process, objective performance appraisal session, they usually bring several problems to managers who earlier had a different way of thinking and taking actions. Now, all such problems should not be allowed to bring any kind of problems in implementing MBO. Now, without everything being openly confronted. Now, managers should believe that MBO would work and must accept, it is a way of thinking. And it shall definitely be benefit both for the organization and even for them. The next one is regarding training. Now, we should remember that MBO is not a ritual to be completed, or it should not be such that it is finished off as quickly as possible. Now, MBO shall always require precise and concrete or a definite thinking. Now, managers should be definitely provided with the time that is necessary or adequate timing for training in MBO philosophy and also all the procedures before such a technique shall be, implemented in the organization. Now, definitely, if at all the organization and environment is such that it is authoritarian or mistrustful climate, then MBO might not be of any use. Now, it is simpler said this way. That is, a plant should always need, a right soil and a right climate if it has to thrive, not only be alive. Similarly, MBO also demands a healthy atmosphere where its philosophy is understood by each one who is participating and the techniques are being properly applied. Now, drawing a curtain between fizzy wishes and specific objective and arranging practice session where performance objectives are evolved, measuring performance and, checking deviations, all these activities do not come by easily. Now, the subordinates as well as the superiors, they must be taught how to set realistic goals and familiarized with the result for which they are to be held responsible. Now, the next one is adequate time and resources. Now, any good or effective MBO program cannot be implemented in a day or two. Now, in a very big organization, it might even take 3 to 5 years of operation or time for implementing before MBO can bring in any kind of yield or fruitful results. Now, implementing this program is usually time consuming process, and also the managers, they have to have necessary time and resources to utilize it. And also it calls for that the managers allocate adequate time and resource to educate each of their subordinates in the organization about the nature or the philosophy of the system. Now, it is no use looking to MBO for instant solution. The next thing is that the organization will have to take care of the necessary mechanics. Now, one reason why MBO program fails is that they shall never be in hand or institutionalized into the real planning and control activities. Now, setting goal is only a part of the story. Now, goals must be supported by different kinds of control activities. activities also. Now, it is very important to assign authority Yes. Now the persons who administer the program, they must also be given with the necessary power not only to punish but also reward people who are working promptly. Now it is always better to clearly mention both the responsibility and authority relationship so that everyone in the organization, they understand what is being expected of them in the system. The next one is timely feedback. That is to tell, we should always monitor MBO as it is put to use. Now the process shall always reveal opportunities for feedback, counseling and encouragement to subordinates other than the regular performance appraisal session. Now in many cases, as it has been mentioned by Nutz, the superiors, they usually, they simply sit back and forget that, maybe the periodic review, counsel and control are mandatory to the success of the program. You know, the subordinate lacking in such direction, they often turns into a mediocre performer. Now, any kind of congratulations or any kind of encouragement from superiors who back up their words with, pay raise and promotions shall always motivate subordinates to increase the performance. Again, while comparing the actual progress of MBO with the planned progress, the managers, they should avoid the tendency of being overly critical with those subordinates who are, lower in ability and lack confidence or are less motivated. Then one more thing that has to be concentrated is regarding the politics. That is to tell, the organization should be sensitive to the policies of implementing MBO. Usually this program, it redistributes power and not only manages, that is tell not only the employees, but there are chances that even managers may not welcome this. Now if MBO is seen as significant change, it shall always generate a hostile reaction, maybe in the form of jokes or in the form of over conflict. Now, MBO can also alter the status of an organization and also it can influence decision. Now, it can affect budgets and can promote creation of coalitions to fight with it. Now, MBO, as has been pointed out by Audiroad, it has failed in many organizations because managers, they quite often ignored this political consideration in the process of implementing it. Okay, now I hope you have understood something more regarding MBO. Now, having discussed so many things, we should also discuss regarding how there has been changes in objectives. Now, we should remember that these objectives of the organization, they are not inflexible guides to behavior. Now, although the organization, it might, tend towards stability, usually as time goes by, or the goals have to change over time. And in fact, practically, they change continuously. Now, goal change means that goals priorities should be by time to time or periodically re-evaluated in the light of changes that shall be happening in the external environment of the organization. Now, the main reason why the goals change are not difficult to understand. It is basically because an organization is not a static element, and a set of objectives can never be static if the organization has to succeed. Now, at times, there are chances that it might demand from coalition groups that make up the enterprise and may change, and the organization may be forced to change its goals. Now, maybe new governments or labor leaders, for example, they may force a change in the way a business sets its goal priorities. For that matter, even the mission can also change in a crisis. Now, we can, to explain this better, we can take the example of, the foundation for infantiline paralysis. Now, this particular foundation, the main goal was committed with the objective of, developing a cure for polio. And this objective, the foundation succeeded. But then, at today's date, this particular objective is no longer has a legitimate, goal for its operation. But now the efforts of the foundation has been, redirected as, new goals or, such as fighting birth defects and arthritis. And also we should remember that organizations' programs and undergo cyclic changes will always result in objectives to change. Now, normally, when there is a change in a goal of the organization, it can be expressed in two forms. First one is goal displacement or goal succession. Now, speaking about this goal displacement, it usually happens when the goals are expressed in a very ambiguous way. Now, the official goals are ignored, an inversion of means and ends change take place. That is to tell, in a hospital, patient care may be the official goal. Now, because of the problems with the space, lack of resources, and maybe because of adequate support from the government, the official goal may be sacrificed in favor of the real goal. Now, that is maybe taking care of rich and influential parties only or influential patients only. Now, when old goals have been achieved, this is about the goal displacement. Regarding goal succession, when the old goals have been achieved or it has been discarded, goal succession takes place. Now, allowing old goals to outlive their utility will be disastrous for the organization. Now, when the organization is confronted with receding, sales, cutthroat competition, shortage of funds, the only way to survive is to find out new goals which can inject a fresh lease of life to the organization. Now, speaking about this goal displacement and goal succession, it also brings the light on the concept of goal incongruence. Now, what is this goal incongruence, or what are the reasons for this goal incongruence? Now, how to account for the differences between maybe the official goal that we discussed or the real goals? Now, even the most successful people in the most successful organization, they usually do not accomplish all their goals all the time because of many reasons. Now, the stated goals, they may be in conflict with each other. Now, they might be intangible, idealistic, or even ambiguous, and there is the likelihood of, generating expectations that cannot be achieved, which might lead to, frustration and disillusionment. Now, creating anxiety and stress because of contradictory demands and some other reasons. Now, in order to reduce the confusion, participants at each level supply operational meaning to goals. Now, clarity and specificity should be accomplished by each manager by applying his own sets of interpretation and biases which lead to goal distortions. Now, goal distortion results when there is a misunderstanding or a misapplication of the goals that has been stated by the organization. When the goals are distorted to an extreme level, then definitely the organization shall be forced to displace them if the organization has to survive. Having said that, goal ignorance is definitely a condition in which there are many or a huge incompatibilities between the goals of the organization, members, and goals of the organization member and those of the organization. So, what might be the reason for this incongruence of goals? The first one is organizational distance. That is, to tell people at lower level, they are definitely not concerned with the big picture, or they cannot even have the information to know the big picture. Now, those who are there in the sales department, they would know nothing about the advertising or the manufacturing department or the procurement department. Here we are trying to speak about the lower level management. Now, every piece of information, it has to travel a huge distance in most of the present day organization. And as a result, participants at each level, they should indulge in filtering or short circuiting and window dressing of messages that has been received depending upon their personal preferences. So, this might be one of the biggest reason for the goal distortion. Now, the second one is subunit goal internalization. That is to tell, when it comes to a huge organization and there is a lot of departments, you know, each of the department, they are constantly in argument or in conflict with one another for having more power and influence in the organization. Now, the long run interest of the organization, because of this reason, shall definitely be sacrificed, you know, in an attempt to build empires or to create enclaves of power and influence, and thus it might result in, you know, subunit goals to be more prioritized over the organizational goals. And lastly, there is, you know, also chance of overcommitment. Now, it is possible for managers to be overcommitted to some of the particular goals or some of the set of the goals. Now, seriously hampering the performance in other areas. Now, overcommitment shall blind managers to the need of new goals, or non-performance or insufficient performance frustrates managers, and they either turn apathetic towards old goals or they try to twist so as to suit their short-run personal interest. And it is also better to know that overcommitment is equally as bad as non-performance in the organization. Now, as we discussed in all the classes, both online and offline classes, the one thing we discussed regarding a business is that it runs in an environment which is in continuously changing. Or we can also tell that the environment in which the business runs is very turbulent in nature. That is to tell, it poses risk every time and every single day. Now, when this is the case, so planning for 5 years or more than that, or planning for a long run, is it useful? Even though if we plan, will it be effective for the organization? Now, all such questions might arise. So, how should be the planning in a turbulent environment is also the question. Now, the first thing is that there should be something called as scenario building. Now, what is the scenario building? Now, scenario building, it involves looking at the current trends and discontinuities and visualizing the future possibilities. It simply means that do not stick on to one particular thing. Do not be inflexible. Make your organization flexible enough, yet it should not be ambiguous. So how should be the planning for all such crises? Now, it can be in 3 different areas, that is prevention, preparation, and containment. When I speak of prevention, it calls for building relationship among the maybe subordinate, the superiors, the management, and the employees from one department to another, or with the organization goals, with the subordinate goals. Now, when there is 2 different interests from 2 different set of elements in the organization, it shall always call for a very good relation to be built between the 2 different interest groups. And we should constantly analyze or be in touch with what is happening in the environment or what is happening around the organization. So it calls for detecting signals from the environment. The next one is, once you know what is happening, once you make your organization a solid organization, what to do? The next is prevention. Now, regarding preparation, there are three steps. That is, crisis management team must be designated. Once it has been effectively implemented, it has to create a detailed crisis management plan and also set up an effective communication system so that the ideas shall be understood, perceived, and also acted upon. And the last one is containment. Now, speaking about containment, it calls for rapid response or activate, the crisis management plan. Now, it gets the awful truth out and it meets safety and emotional needs, and also it should bring return to the business. So, this is how one can plan in a turbulent environment. Now, whatever we discussed up until today is all that you have in your syllabus for the second chapter. So thereby here we end two chapters of your syllabus and six more to go. Now, speaking about this chapter, there has been a few slides which I have given. Now, it can be extra notes or it can also be the notes. The thing is that going away from the textbook or going away from one particular textbook or what has been there in one book, in this extra notes, what has been given is that it has many of the textbooks has been referred, and in a very simple way, the concept has been given to you all. So, the objectives and the MBO has been explained in a very easy term. Now, here they speak about the objectives. It specifies the end results which the organization wants to achieve. And each organization or group of individuals would definitely have an objective. Now, these can be broad or they may be specifically mentioned, or it can be clearly mentioned, or there are chances they might not be clear. Now, there are chances that the organization might have one single objective or it might have multiple objectives. And it also speaks about objectives have hierarchy. Now, management by objective or management by results. Now, these have drawn, considerable attention of both the academicians and also the practitioners. Now, it focuses sharply on the objectives or results which a manager is expected to achieve within the given specified period. Now, it also emphasizes participative management and an approach which provides, high motivation to individual group. Now, this particular term was coined by Peter Drucker in the year 1954. Now, since that time, many organizations, both business and non-business, have adopted this. The next slide speaks about the definition. Now, it is nothing but a comprehensive managerial system that brings together key managerial activities in a systematic manner, which will always be directed towards the efficient and effective achievement of the organizational objective. Then you have the features of MBO. The next one is the process of MBO. In the earlier that we learned, we had discussed regarding the process only in three different steps. Here you have six different steps. First one being where the organization try to, sets its purpose and its objective.
Now, what the explanation is, how one should set organizational purpose and objectives. Then it speaks of key results area. Once after it has been mentioned, then there shall be setting of subordinate objectives so that the objectives of the organization shall be accomplished with the help of these smaller objectives or the derived objectives. Or according to the types that we studied, they are the operational plans. Then the fourth step is the resources, they have to be matched with the objectives. Once after this is done, the appraisal of especially the subordinates. And once after it is done, the continuity of the process is demanded. Then you have benefits of MBO. The first one is in terms of better managing. The second one is in terms of clarity in organization goals. Then in terms of personal satisfaction and the basis for organizational change. Then you have limitations of MBO, that is in terms of time and cost. Now failure to teach MBO philosophy and problems in objective setting, emphasis on short-term objective, inflexibility and frustration. At last you have prerequisites for installing MBO. Now what are these prerequisites? Are nothing but the conditions that are to be present in organization so that the MBO as a method can be effectively introduced in an organization. That is, the first one is purpose of MBO. If we remember what we studied regarding the effectiveness, how to bring in effectiveness in MBO is nothing but the prerequisites. The first one is the purpose of the MBO, that is to tell there should be clarities regarding the reason why the MBO is being implemented. The next thing is that support from the top management. Training should be given for the people who are being a part of this MBO. There should be participation from their side, and regarding the feedback for the self-direction and self-control. And how shall it be implemented in the lower level? Now this particular slide speaks about how management by objective is present in Indian organization. So thereby we end this particular chapter. I hope whatever we discussed you have understood. If you have any doubts, if you have any confusion, or if you need any extra explanation, do let me know. Now thank you class for your patience listening. You may leave the meeting now.